How do you feel about sampling, remaking, remixing?
Sometimes it can be really cool.
There are artists like Girl Talk who create entirely new works from hundreds of familiar samples.
Sometimes you're like,
yeah, freedom of the people. That's what I'm talking about.
But other times you're like,
I don't know about this. And there's a lot that falls in between.
Oh, why you look so sad?
Sé que no vendrás todo lo que fue. El tiempo lo dejó.
If I were a rich man, yabba dibba 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 dum.
Touch this.
I wear my sunglasses at night.
I got my sights set on you, and I'm ready to wait.
I got a heart that will never be tamed. Is this thing on? So I really want to examine, not just legally speaking, but in terms of our gut reaction. What makes some things seem like ripoffs and other things legitimized as new works of art? Does it matter whether the song is literally taking bits from another recording or if they're just borrowing some riffs for an original performance? It's legally very important, but does it matter to us listeners? Is it about whether they pay the original artist? Some of those clips were paid for and some of them weren't. With hundreds and hundreds of sampled songs, Girl Talk would have a hell of a time trying to license them all. Girl Talk uses samples as if they're instruments or a color of paint on a palette. It's not as if he's just cutting and pasting. But would anyone say that's less creative than just sampling a whole verse from a single song?
Dear Slim, I wrote you, but you still ain't calling. I left my cell, my pager, and my home phone at the bottom.
And the issue isn't just about artists getting paid when you're talking about sample. It's about permission. The record label has control. In the world of fan fiction, George Lucas used to give everyone free rein to write with his characters and stories. What did he care? He's rich. But then he saw some erotic Star Wars fan fiction, and he was like, oh, snap. Oh, no, she didn't. It wasn't about getting compensated, it was about keeping control of his characters. So what would New Line and Tolkien's estate think about reading some freaky Bilbo on Gandalf erotic fiction? And in turn, what would the serious slash fictionist think about having her work read for comedic value by comedian Chris Gethard?
Bilbo moved over just enough so he could hump his own happy cock on Gandalf's firm thigh. Mmm, he sucked on the head.
Nice. That's another thing to think about. It's not just a big guy to little guy one-to-one sampling. Everything gets interpreted and reinterpreted. And in this case, the person being sampled probably wouldn't like the interpretation. Copyright says they have a right to protect their work. But should they? The free flow of information lets each of these transitions reinvent and remediate the prior work to make it accessible to an entirely new audience. It's pretty cool. The question is, how much control should a copyright-given author? Is it okay to appropriate someone's work in a way in which they wouldn't approve? And how much do you have to change a work of art before it feels like you're not just ripping it off? YouTuber Buffalax takes crazy Bollywood videos in their entirety, and he just adds his own fake English subtitles. Clearly, that video wouldn't exist without the original artists. But would the video itself alone have attracted as much attention without the subtitles? Who knows? They need each other. Kind of like Bilbo and Gandalf.
To a hobbit so inclined, a nice large heaping of wizard cock was a feast.
Nice. Let's go back to Miley Cyrus. Not just because she's totally legal in the state of Pennsylvania.
I got my sights set on you.
Sure, it's reminiscent of...
I wear my sunglasses at night.
But doesn't that seem a little bit like...
Sweet dreams are made of these.
This is nothing new. take
A, B, C, D, E, F,
and
Twinkle, twinkle, little star.
Sounds good.
Sound familiar? And Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star was nothing but a mashup of a Mozart song, which itself was a remake of a French folk song, and an English nursery rhyme poem by Jane Taylor. In fiction too, Shakespeare didn't just happen. The tragical history of Romeus and Juliet by Italian author Arthur Brooke long before Shakespeare? Ring any bells? And if we kept Shakespeare out of the Creative Commons today, we wouldn't have brilliant reimaginings like Troma Film's horror masterpiece, Tromeo and Juliet.
What light from yonder plexiglass breaks? It is a right-angled cosmos. And Juliet is its sun.
Look, maybe I'm just being Miley here, but it seems like the ability to sample and remix prior works is something that's fueled the art community for generations. And sometimes, even sampling that doesn't seem so creative can get remixed again into something new.
I sit back with my brand new invention. Something that's holding me tightly, flow like a hawk, daily and nightly. Will it ever stop, yo? I don't know. Turn off the lights, and I'll glow.
And that's all I've got.